So for this week's project, we're going to be stepping back in time to the 1970s to have a look at this very nice old realistic model TR-802 8-track tape deck. And of course, this is a standalone unit. There's line in and line out connections in the back for hooking it to your receiver. And this unit belongs to a family member. He had this stashed in his garage attic for probably about 30 years. The unit belonged to his dad. And we don't really have any information about it. I'm gonna imagine at this point, I didn't even hook it up, didn't even try to put a tape in it. I'm sure we're gonna find the usual suspects in this. A very good or stretched out capstan belt. And I can't imagine what kind of noise would be produced by those record level sliders over there on the right. So as always, we'll get it opened up and see if we can figure out what's going on with it. And this one does have a few features on it that you wouldn't expect to find in your average 8-track deck from back in the day, including Dolby noise reduction. So it'll be interesting to get it up, opened up, and see if we can figure out what's going on and even record a tape in it and play it back and see what kind of audio quality this thing can produce. We're going back to 1979 for our intro music. Listen to the Styx Cornerstone album. I remember my oldest brother having this exact album on 8-track. And we're going to listen to a little bit of my favorite song from this one. This is Borrowed Time. So we'll hear a little bit of this, and then we'll get started on the 8-track deck. All right, we'll pick back up and we'll have a look at the controls and buttons they provided for us, starting at the far left over here. We have a manual eject button, and this is a soft touch control or a momentary switch. So it's making me wonder if there's a mechanism in here that'll automatically drive the tape out once it's done playing at the end of all four tracks, or you can just manually do it from here. Some of these 8-track decks from back in the day, you didn't actually have to pull the tape out to eject it. They had a mechanism there that would do it for you. So I'm wondering if that's what that's all about. We also have a fast forward in case you want to speed it up to the next track. We have a pause button and, of course, the program button, of course, with the four light indicators to give you an indication of which channel you're on or which track you're on. This one does have a tape counter built into it. There's a large orange record button here, and of course the way that this works is you hold the button in, and then once you push your tape in, it will lock the button in place to put the unit into record. We have Dolby noise reduction and some tape convenience features here, like repeat, which means it will basically repeat either the track or the entire tape, but I believe continuous is that it just continues on playing at the end of all four tracks and won't stop until you pull the tape out or eject the tape. We have auto stop, and then we have auto stop each, which means auto stop after each track and then auto stop at the end of all four tracks. And we have our switch for source, whether it be the microphones for the quarter inch inputs here or the auxiliary, which means the line in from the back of the unit. We've got a couple of VU meters here, and I don't know how close this camera will get you in, but you can see the paint is starting to peel off of the actual needles from the meters. I'm sure this probably has to do with the fact that it was stored in that nice hot attic for all those years. And then the slider controls for the left and right record level. Let's spin it around and we'll have a look at the back of it. Not much to see, but we'll check it out. We do have our output level control, as well as preamp out and auxiliary in, and then some identifying information, model number 14-928. I have all the catalogs from 1980 to 1989. I'd have to look in the 1980 catalog. I'm sure they probably still sold this there, and if they do, we'll have a look at the page of that later on. And then, of course, made in Korea, custom manufactured in Korea for Radio Shack. So once we get it opened up, maybe we can determine if it truly was custom manufactured or if it was rebranded for Radio Shack by another manufacturer. So got a little bit to get into here. So I think the first thing we should probably do, let's go ahead and get it out of this wood cabinet and have a look at the inside of it and see where we're at on that. So give me a moment and I'll get it taken apart and we'll pick back up. All right, so we'll come back in. We'll have a look at the unit now that it's taken apart and basically discovered our counter belt just kind of laying in there, not really connected to anything. And it's a very straightforward mechanism. This one was very popular back in the 70s. So there's no identifying information on the motor as far as who made the actual unit, but it doesn't look like it's, you know, Pioneer, Hitachi, anybody like that. It's probably from one of the lower level manufacturers, maybe Sound Design, somebody like that, maybe. I don't really know because there is nothing on this that identifies it. It's possible, the only reason I mention it is because the record, the output level control is in the back of it, but it's possible it could be Hitachi, maybe. But I just don't see anything here that gives me a dead indication of who made it for them. Now, underneath, we find the capstan belt still intact. Now, let's see if I can flip it over here. We found the capstan belt still intact and still unbelievably in okay shape. It is turning, no trouble. And this is the mechanism that drives the tape out. There's a solenoid here that will click this wheel to get it started, and the capstan will drive and push the tape out of it. So it does have that cool automatic eject feature on it. So given the fact that we have a capstan belt that's intact, there wouldn't be any reason why we can't go ahead and hook some power up to this thing, put a tape in it, and see if it'll play it. He had a old tape case that was falling apart with a bunch of tapes in it. Unfortunately, I didn't find a copy of Cornerstone by Styx, but I did find a Neil Young tape. So we'll go ahead and test his unit out with one of the tapes that probably used to get played in it. But other than that, obviously just the same stuff that we would find in any one of those typical 8-tracks from back in the day. Very condensed, small playback record amp, the Dolby noise reduction circuitry on a separate board that's got plug and socket so it could be removed if you wanted to do any work to that. Power supply, transformer, a few caps there. There is a half wave bridge rectifier, I believe, down in there. And that's pretty much it. I'll go ahead and wire it over into the mixer and we'll put a tape in it and we'll see what it'll do. So give me a second for that. All right, picking back up with you. Got a tape in it, it is working. But we got some trouble. Turn it up a little bit. Basically, we got two songs playing at the same time, so we got some crosstalk between one track into the other track. And let's turn this down. And that is coming from right here. That plastic housing that holds the playback and record head You can clearly see here on this side of it that it's cracked. And of course, this screw is how you, you know, do the adjustment for the head, so it's hitting both tracks, the left and the right channels of whatever track you're on correctly, but that's cracked. And of course, it's causing the head not to sit correctly. And so there's that, as well as no meter movement. I'm not sure what that's all about. This may be a model where they only move if it's in record. I wouldn't think that's the case, but could be. But as we just heard, I did change tracks. No trouble with that. See, we're hearing, let's turn this up some. See, Hot Legs is not on track two. Hot Legs is on track one. So definitely out of adjustment there. In the beginning, I tried the tape that came with the unit that I brought back with the unit. And unfortunately, I had some sound for a second and then it quit. I pulled the tape out and the tape snapped in half and it's gone forever. So I guess the first thing we'll try to address is how we're going to fix this. I'll have to get this assembly out and see if there's a way to fuse that back together, put some kind of brace on it to make sure it doesn't come back apart. I'm sure if that side of it's frail, then probably the whole thing is. So probably require taking this apart. So maybe we'll mount the camera overhead and we'll start taking this apart and see if we can get down to where this is at and figure out what we're going to do about it. So give me a minute for that. All right, so I'm going to pick back up with you. And basically, we're in this area right here. We're going to remove this C-clip. Let's see if I can get you in a little closer there. We're going to move this C-clip, which will get this little circuit board off, which this is basically just the contact board for the track indicator lights. And then I believe everything under here should be pretty straightforward. It's been a while since I've taken one of these apart, but if I remember right, there's some springs and some things that'll go boing. So we're going to have to kind of pay attention to that, not let things get too crazy. Let's see here. I want to make sure we don't lose any of the hardware, so I'm going to put it over in the little plastic dish I've got over here. And this should just come right out. Kind of move that out of the way. It looks like that could use a pretty good cleaning. And then there's the actual little contact piece. Clean that up too, the spring. Now, I believe this gear is not going to come out because the solenoid's in the way. So let's take that loose. Should be able just to move it out of the way with the other screw loose. Here comes that. And then this piece, maybe. And there should be a spring there. We'll leave that. Should be all right. Now. And then this spring just rides against this post. And then comes up against the pin on this head assembly right here. But now that we got it out, we can certainly see that it is broke. I've got to figure out what I'm going to do about it. And I suppose that this screw really doesn't have much to do with adjustment. It's more for just mounting the head in here. Upon second look at this. Let's make sure we don't lose this. And it looks like the whole thing is getting ready to fall apart. And working on it with these wires in here is going to be a problem too. Uh-oh. Felt something fall out. There it is right there. It's just a little shim. It goes underneath the head.
where that ground plate is. Yeah, so working on this with these wires is kind of a problem. But I ain't going to desolder them from the head. If I have to desolder them, we'll do it at the board. But we'll try to see what we can work with without taking the wires off at all. Let's zoom out a little bit. So yeah, I'm not sure how I'm going to figure this out. I'll have to think up something. So I'm going to pause here, contemplate this, and see what I can come up with for a fix. And then I'll pick back up with you. All right, I'm going to pick back up with you. It's going to be about an hour and a half later. And I took some time for lunch and then came back with a fresh brain to try to figure out how I'm going to do this. And I want to preface all of this by saying it's very possible that there are replacement parts for this on the used market, but I just don't feel comfortable with buying a part that's as old as the original one in here and have the exact same thing happen. So I just kind of fabricated a method to get it fixed. And basically what I did was I took a piece of aluminum from a curtain rod that's really flimsy, it's really thin, but yet durable, and kind of formed it out to fit around that housing. And it took me obviously three tries. On the third try, I was able to get it exactly the way I wanted it. And the way that this kind of lines up here, let's see if we can get this thing to focus, is it goes all the way around the entire frame of this, comes back to the top, and on my second attempt at trying to get this to line up, the actual plastic broke at the top as well as over here on the side. And so from that point, I pretty much had to put a nut underneath it to brace it from the top and then, you know, form my piece of aluminum around it. After I got it all put together the way I wanted it, I went ahead and melted the plastic kind of into itself, and everything is real stable. That head is in this assembly very, very well, so there shouldn't be any issue at all. Went ahead and put the ground plate back in there too, and so we're going to put this back together, and hopefully this will be the fix for this. But not an easy one to do, just simply because it's hard to, you know, hard to figure out how to do this and make sure that it's reliable. I mean, of course, a lot of people would say, well, how come you didn't just epoxy it or use some kind of JB weld or something like that? And the reason I never do that is because those things aren't permanent. Those are not a permanent fix. This is permanent. The only thing that's going to collapse this is if all of the plastic around this metal frame just disintegrates into dust. But from my vantage point here, I think we're going to be okay. We're going to go ahead and use this, and we're going to get it all put back together, and we'll see if we got a winner. All right, picking back up with you. This is going to be day two, and I did get the head assembly reinstalled. Everything working very well there. There is an adjustment screw that you access from underneath the bottom of the mechanism that will give you the correct azimuth of this, and I did go ahead and get that adjusted up real nice. And so we've got both channels with no crosstalk from any other channel, and we're using our second favorite bench test tape, 8-track, Gary Newman, the Pleasure Principle, and it is working very nice. I'll go ahead and turn it up a little bit in the mixer. We can hear both left and right channel. We'll kick on the Dolby and listen to that a little bit. Seems like it's doing pretty good here. Well, I think at this point we're going to have to go ahead and cut it off. I've kind of ran out of time this weekend, and we'll pick back up on this one next week for part two, where we'll have to go ahead and address these meters. I don't understand why they're not working. I got one of them that's kind of moving a little bit, got itself stuck into about the mid position, so we could have a lubrication issue we'll have to address, and then figure out how we're going to replace all of the paint that has fallen off the needles. So we'll address all that in part two, but at this point I feel pretty lucky that we're able to figure out a way to get the head assembly stabilized to where the head would rest securely in that and get it up and playing again. So it's all doing pretty good. So as always, I want to thank you guys very much. Appreciate you checking out the video, and appreciate all the new people that signed up to check out the channel. So hopefully one of the videos has helped you with something you might be working on. But we will definitely pick back up on this one next week and see if we can get it completed. I'd love to get it to the point to where the meters are functional, and also we can get a blank tape in this thing and make a recording. That would be ideal for me. So until next week, hope everybody's doing well and is healthy. See you later.